Happy Mother's Day to all the moms. Amen. It's good to be in the house of the Lord.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
God has been faithful. God has been good.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Amen. Especially to moms, because we have so much going on.
Yep.
So it's by the grace of God that we get to do whatever we do. Amen. Would you please stand with us this morning? Oh, praise the Lord. Let's see who's out there. Carmen, come here, baby. I'm going to have her open up the service with a prayer.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Good morning, church. Good morning. Thank you, Lord, for this beautiful, awesome day that you have provided for us, Father. Thank you for the wonderful things that you have given us and the wonderful things you have for us today, Father. I ask you, Father, for travel mercies for everyone that's coming right now, Father God, and continue to bless us. And thank you for this day, Father God, and whatever you bring today, Father God, let them leave it at the altar, Father God, that then when they walk out of here, Father God, they feel your presence, your love, Father God, and your grace, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Amen. Let's worship the Lord this morning.
We'll sing, oh, 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 oh. Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, God. man that you should lie, my God, but that your promises are true. And that your word is yes and amen. We praise you, Lord God. You said it, and I believe it. You said it, and it is done. You said it, and I believe it. You said it, and it is done.
Worship the Lord this morning. Lift your hands up, lift your burdens up to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Who can do anything but Jesus Christ? He's the lover of our souls. We look to Him for all of our needs, for all of the things that matter to us. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, that you loved us so much that you sent your only Son.
Thank you.
you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns forever all my days. Hallelujah.
Come on, lift your voice to the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Forever all my days.
Hallelujah. Could we all raise our hands and worship? Just continuing worshiping the Lord right now. Lord, you are worthy, Father God. Lord, we thank you, Jesus, that we can come here today, Lord God. Lord, just in your presence, Lord, we thank you for such a special day today, Lord God, a day where we're here to honor mothers, Lord God. But Lord, we just want to come and praise you, Lord, and just thank you, Lord God, for the life that you've given us through them, Lord Jesus, Lord. Father God, I pray a blessing, Lord Jesus, over every mother here, every person here, everyone who's come in here, Lord. And today, Jesus, we just pray that you will move in a mighty way this morning, Lord God. Lord, we thank you, Lord God. We worship you. We honor you, Lord God. And we pray that today your blessing will be on the service, that we'll leave here differently, Lord Jesus, that you'll sow a word into our spirit that will change us forever, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Good morning, everybody. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. You may all be seated today. We have a very special service lined up for us. Amen. First thing I want to say is happy Mother's Day. Pastor Nancy, could I have you stay up here real quick? I just want to give Pastor Nancy a big hug because this is my spiritual mother right here, as to all of us here in the church. Amen.
My baby.
Amen.
That's my baby too.
Amen. Amen. We just want to thank God for every mother in this church, really. Every lady here, when I came here, my mom was a member of this church. She's in Buffalo right now at my sister's church. But every lady in this church has played a role in spiritually mothering me. And church, we have a great spiritual mother here to lead us, to help us. Even if you have a mom, you know, we still need spiritual mothers and fathers also to be there for us. And that's who Pastor Nancy is to us, and we love her. And I just want to let you guys know that I got the best mother-in-law in the world. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Nancy. God bless you. All right, you guys ready for a special service today? Special announcements? Oh, Elder Gail, come on up. Would you please do the honors of telling me what we're doing?
We could have Pastor Nancy and Pastor Crystal come up. Just want to wish both of you a happy Mother's Day. And we just, so we just I just want to say that you guys are so very special to us, and you're a spiritual mother to me, too. And we just wish you many, many blessings to you and your families forever, forever and ever. And we thank you for all that you do. Amen. 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 Amen.
Praise God. What would a special service be without a beautiful gift from our children's church to our mothers over here? So at this time, I'd like to ask our children to come on up. Amen. Come on up, kids.
I forgot the words. gift that will last for eternity. That was the worst fail. Did you see by my side in my stories at night? Teach me to trust in God's love. You give me.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I'll take them all. That's the best, isn't it, guys? Amen. All these beautiful children here surely got their looks and their voices from their parents. Amen. Caleb got his memory from me, so amen. Praise God. What a beautiful service today. How many of you are ready to bless the house of the Lord? We still have some more planned for us, amen. But we take up an offering right now, and we want to let you know that if you're a guest with us today, if it's your first time visiting, you're under no obligation to give. If the Lord puts that on your heart, that's absolutely fine. But we're here to bless you today, amen. We want you to be blessed, welcome here at our church. Feel at home. See that we're just a bunch of people who love God, amen. We're your friends, we're your neighbors, your co-workers, and this is a great church to be in. So could we all stand this morning? And if you need an envelope, please raise your hand. We hand out these envelopes. If you put your information on there, we give you a form at the end of the year, a donation form, just so that you could log what you've been donating throughout the year. So that's what these envelopes are for. But could we raise our hands up unto God this morning? Lord, you've been so good to us, so faithful, Lord Jesus. We find ourselves here in your house, Lord God, because the gospel was preached to us, Lord Jesus. Lord, we pray that you continue this amazing work, Lord God. I pray, Lord Jesus, that all of these resources are used for your kingdom and your glory, Lord. I pray, Lord Jesus, that you bless every person here and help us be good stewards of everything that comes through here. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Give and be blessed. Father God, we pray that you bless these offerings in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. All right, children, I'd like to invite you to go down to Children's Church today. Amen. Praise God. All right. We'd like to bless you with another very, very special gift of song. Now, there's some amazing people that come to this church, truly gifted. You know that these people are just going to go so far in life. I think he's a future celebrity that we have here. But he asked if he could sing a song for his mother on behalf of the mothers here today. And we're like, thank you. There's no one else that would like to come and sing other than you. So I'd like to ask Richie Gardilli to come up and to sing for us this morning.
Testing. All right, good morning. Happy Mother's Day, everybody, to the mothers. My mom has been nagging me to sing this song for 4 years since I tagged her in it on Facebook. So here you go. Isn't she lovely? Isn't she wonderful? Isn't she precious? Such a beautiful soul. I never thought that I would be a son of someone as lovely as she. Pretty, truly the angel's best. Boy, I'm so happy. I have been heaven blessed. I can't believe what God has done. I might be the luckiest son, but isn't she lovely? Isn't she lovely? Isn't she wonderful? Isn't she precious? Such a beautiful soul. I can't believe I get to be son of someone as lovely as she. But isn't she lovely? Isn't she lovely?
Amen. And that one was for free, guys. You did not have to go pay on Broadway to hear that one. Amen. I'd just like to say to my mom, if you're watching online, everything he said, I mean that to you. Amen. I wish I could sing it as good as that. Sounds good. We have another gift, and this gift is a very special one because it's from mothers, amen. And are they ready? I'm just curious. Back there, can I get a thumbs up? No? All right, praise the Lord. So at this point, what would you like me to do? Some stand up, past stand? All right, sounds good. So at this time, we want to ask Pastor Dan, can you come and lead us in a powerful message? Guys, today you're going to be so blessed with a great message to take home with you. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Happy Mother's Day to all. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Are we alive out there? Amen. Yeah. Amen. Okay, good. Richie, thank you so much for singing that song. I don't think we could have done a better job than you did. Thank you so much for expressing our appreciation to our mothers. And we thank God for mothers. Diana's not here today. No, she's not here. Let's keep on praying for our Elder Emeritus, Diane Simpson. And we love her. Just tell her we love her. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Can we stand for the reading of the word? Get the house lights. For those that have a Bible, if not, you can read it up here. Usually on Father's Day, it's a man-bashing service. When you go to churches, they talk about fathers. You have to be responsible because we know mothers are responsible. We know mothers are good. Fathers are evil, you know. But this is not this type of message. In fact, this message is not only for the mothers, but it's for all of us. We can take my goal is that today you take a doggy bag home with you. And you can take stuff that can apply to your life and make a difference. And today we're going to talk about what I believe is probably one of the top five most powerful mothers in the Bible. Of course, we know Mary, the mother of Jesus. She has top billing. We know that, being the son, the mother of the Son of God. You can't beat that. But this is another mother that I think we could learn from. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 23, if they could put that up. Can I get a bottle of water, please? Usually in the morning, my voice takes time for it to warm up. So when you call me, Brother Santos called me this morning. He asked me if I was still asleep. I said, no, my voice is like that in the morning. Folks, this is a very powerful, powerful, powerful verse right here. And if you could take this home with you, it will literally revolutionize your life. It did mine. I want to read this. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 23. It reads, by faith, Moses' parents hid him for 3 months after he was born, because they saw he was no ordinary child, and they were not afraid of the king's edict. It's a lot of information in that. Question is, what does that have to do with you? And what does that have to do with me? Today we will find out. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, speak to us. Let me get out of the way so that you can show up and speak to our lives. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 You may be seated if you can. Well, how many of you are glad to be in the house of the Lord? Amen? Yes. Amen. I'm going to take this. I don't know if I'll be able to preach. No, I won't be able to. Amen. Everyone knows the story of Moses. In fact, in this verse in the Bible, it talks about Moses' parents. They're unnamed in this verse. But when we go into the specific narrative of the story, we know that it was his mother who did most of the heavy lifting. In scripture, we find out that his parents are Amram and his mother is Jochebed. Jochebed was a very special lady, because according to scripture, it says, by faith, Moses' parents hid him for 3 months after he was born, because they saw he was no ordinary child. Well, this story starts in Exodus chapter 2, verse 1 through 10. By the end of Exodus chapter 1, the Pharaoh of Egypt, perhaps Ramses II, had decreed that all the Hebrew boy babies were to be drowned at birth, would be cast in the river Nile. But when Jochebed, Moses' mother, gives birth, she decides to hide her son. Now, I want you to understand, the soldiers are being dispatched. Find every baby boy and throw them into the river Nile for them to drown, for them to be eaten by crocodiles, for them to be attacked by serpents. It was a certain death for these baby boys. Can you imagine someone taking your baby away from you, and you know that your baby is going to wind up in the Nile River, and you can feel helpless about that? They could not fight against the soldiers. They could not fight against Pharaoh. They just had to surrender. Imagine for a second, put yourself in their shoes. How would you feel if you knew that when they ripped that baby out of your hands, it was going into the river Nile, or the Nile River? But this story is very interesting, because it says this woman, Jochebed, she said no. She said no. She said no. She just did not accept the fate of her son. She said, I know it's happening to everyone else, but it's not going to happen to me. That's why in Hebrews it says, by faith, This woman had faith, and I'm encouraging you to have faith today. And this message is not just for the mothers, but it's for anyone who lives life. The Bible says that she hid him for 3 months. And it says because they saw that he was no ordinary child. In Acts chapter 7, it refers to Moses as being a child fair to God. In his beauty, Jochebed saw a promise of a future blessing, and they believed God had a plan for their son. Let me tell you something. There is a river Nile. There is a river Nile filled with crocodiles. There's a river Nile filled with serpents. There's a river, river Nile waiting to devour your children up. But she looked at her boy and she saw that God had a plan for that son. She saw something different. And it's time that we start seeing what God is seeing. It's time. It's time that we now look and say, my son is on his way to the river Nile, but I'm going to hide him because God has a plan for my child. God has a plan for my marriage. God has a plan for my family. God has a plan for my future. I'm not going to give up. There is a river Nile. And it's eating up our youth. It's eating up our marriages. It's eating up our families, our health. That river Nile is real. In that day, it was filled with crocodiles. In that day, it was filled with serpents. The river Nile wants to destroy everything God has given you. And there's the enemy, the agents of the enemy, knocking at your door saying, give me what God has given you. It's going into the river Nile. And you could be like some people say, okay, I guess there's nothing I can do about it. That's life. They're going to make decisions or life is going to work out a certain way. You can surrender today or you can say, wait a minute. God has a plan. No, wait a minute. No. He didn't bring me this far to let me down now. See, God has a plan. I may not know how, I may not know when, I may not have all the details, but I'm going to believe God that what he gave me belongs to me. Hello, someone. That what he gave me is for my blessing. Amen. Folks, I encourage you to see your marriage like God sees it. Hallelujah. I encourage you to see your family like God sees it. I encourage you to see yourself like God sees you. He sees you as a head and not the tail. He sees you like a blessed person, not a cursed person. He sees you beloved and not cursed. You need to see what God sees. I'm going to say it again. You need to see what God sees. The devil's trying to convince you that you're a failure. The devil's trying to convince you you've made too many mistakes. The devil's trying to convince you that it's too late for you. And he's knocking at your door saying, give me what God has given you. I'm going to throw it in the river now. But Jochebed said, no, I'm going to hide him. I'm going to hide him. And she did everything in her power. You know, you could do everything in your power to try to fix a problem. And sometimes it doesn't work. Amen. She hid him for 3 months. But then she found out she couldn't hide a crying baby. She realized that a baby, let me tell you something, I don't know anything, but I believe Puerto Rican babies cry louder than the other babies. Right? I don't know what that means, but my babies were loud. I'm not saying perhaps he was half Puerto Rican. The Bible does not tell us Moses was half Puerto Rican. Just want to clarify that. Moises, yes. But she hid him for 3 months, and for 3 months, she was successful. But then, the neighbors started to ask questions. How many of you have noisy neighbors? Amen. Some people don't have a life, don't they? And I could just imagine that there were raids happening next door and babies were being confiscated. And she says, wait a minute, something's got to change. I can't do this anymore. Have you ever come to a point where you can't do this anymore? Have you? How many, am I the only person here? Have you ever come where you've tried, and you come to a point and say, I can't do this anymore? Can I hear an amen? Maybe it's just me. Can you get me therapy or something? Because maybe it's just me. I think it's me. That I come to a point because I try so hard to fix things, and it's like running in place. Some of you are looking at me like I have two heads, but it's okay. One day you'll understand what I'm saying. And she tried for 3 months and it didn't work. She knew her son was going to wind up in the Nile River. But she made a decision. My son is going to wind up in the Nile River. But he's going to be there on my terms. She built a basket. The Bible doesn't say when she built it. It's probably throughout those 3 months. But the Bible says that she took a basket, filled it with pitch and tar, making it waterproof, representative and symbolic of Noah's ark. That was going to come in the future. We see here that she built a basket. I'm encouraging you to build a basket too. She says, I can't stop the king from taking my son. He's going to go into the Nile River, but I'm going to build a basket for him. You can't stop life from hitting you. Life is going to be hard. You're going to have disappointments, but build a basket. Life is going to come and try to eat you up alive and throw whatever you have that is precious to you into the Nile River. But today you can leave here to deciding, I'm going to build a basket. See, she built a basket because her son was important. You will never fight for something that you don't see importance in. You will always fight for things that are important to you. You need to fight. You need to fight. You need to fight.
Hallelujah.
If it's important to you, you need to fight. She built a basket. She could have made excuses. And let me tell you something. We have a society full of excusers. We have an excuse for everything. We can easily blame everyone. It's his fault, my fault. It was trauma. It was. I'm not saying those things are not real. Yeah, those things are real. But at the end of the day, you got to take responsibility for your own life. Now, yes, people hurt you. People did said things to you that were bad. People abused you. Oh God, and my heart breaks for you. But you need to build a basket. Because if not, the Nile River is going to swallow you up whole. She came to a point where she says, my son is going into the Nile River, but I'm going to build him a basket. She put Moses in there. You could put anything in there. You could put your children. You could put your relationships. You could put your home. You could put your health. Anything that God has given you, I'm going to put it in a basket. It's going to go in the Nile River. What kind of basket should you build? Let me say this to you. I'm going to tell you one thing. There's no greater basket than the basket of prayer. Hello, someone. There's no greater. And many of you are here because somebody prayed for you. I know you're all big and bad. I know you have the nice job. I know you drive the nice car. God bless you. Go in peace. Amen. But you're there because someone prayed for you. Someone interceded for you. Someone broke heaven open for you. And if you are blessed today, it's because somebody cried out to God. Thank you, Lord. through the basket of prayer. Cover your children in prayer. Cover your family in prayer. Cover your relationships in prayer. Cover your health in prayer. Devil, if you're going to take me into the Nile River, go ahead. But I've got a basket of prayer. I've got a basket of the power of God in my life. I'm going to trust God. I'm going to believe God. No matter what Nile River you'll be in, if God is for you, who can be against you? God will be with you. Come on, give the Lord a praise. Isaiah 43 verse 2 says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. Through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor the flame scorch you. God promised to be with you. But I read verse 2. We love verse 2. It says, when you pass through the waters, I'm going to be with you. When you go through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you should not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. We love that part. But we got to go to the previous verse to find the qualifier. These things will happen only if verse 1 happens. And he says, but now thus says the Lord, who created you, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. Amen. So whatever you're putting in that basket, you first have to give it to God. See, a king, for him to be a king over a kingdom, has to do two basic things. If he fails in doing these two basic things, they will overthrow him. The first thing is, you've got to provide for the people. You got to feed the people. If you don't feed the people, let me say to you, I know the nicest Christian people, in 38 years of ministry, I've met the nicest Christian people that I could have ever met. But I've also seen these people when they're hungry. They're not the nicest people. Amen. Some of you are so beautiful, but when you're hungry, you get hangry. Does anyone? Some of you don't know what I'm talking about. But as a king, if you don't give food, if you don't provide, people will revolt, say, we want a king that will give us what we need. And the second thing is, you have to protect your kingdom. You got to protect them from the enemy. See, when God is your kingdom, when he's the king of your kingdom, he provides all your needs according to his riches and glory. Amen. He takes care of you. He gives you whatever you need. When he's your king, he protects you from whatever attack of the enemy. I don't care how evil the devil is. God will protect you. God will stand guard. His angel will stand in your home. Hallelujah. Oh, he protects his people. Now, when you're the king of your kingdom, when you say, God, I've got this. God, I believe in you. I think you're cool, but I've got this. I know what these other people, but they're weak. I've got this, God. And you become the king of your kingdom. Well, now you have two responsibilities. You have to provide for your kingdom, and you have to protect your kingdom. And that's when the enemy will come in and destroy everything. Because you don't have the capacity to do those things. You've been trying to work on your relationship. You've been trying to work on your family. You've been trying to work with your child, your wayward child. You've trying to work with your runaway child. And you're trying to work and everything. You need to abdicate your kingdom and make him the king of your kingdom. And then he says, the waters won't overtake you. Why? Because you are mine. Because you are mine. Hallelujah. I'll tell you this one story. And every time I tell this story, I'm remembered by one of the elders of the church, Elder Grumpy. Amen. Dennis. And he's with the Lord. And I remember we did this story and we illustrated it. And you know, Brother Dennis, you know, we told him what to say, exactly what to say. And this guy was ad-libbing and just ridiculous, just ridiculous. But I'll tell you the story. I'll tell you the story. It was about this one person who brought this great house. He finally saved up, and he brought this great mansion, in fact. And it was beautiful. It had marble floors, had great paintings. It was a dream house. You could say it was a McMansion. You know, those mansions that all look the same. It was a beautiful home. And sometimes God will give you good stuff, and we forget about him. Well, he had this house, and he decided to throw a party. And he invited everyone. He invited Jay-Z and J-Lo and I can't remember anybody else. Ricky Martin. So there was an A-list of invitees there, and everybody was there, and everybody was like, yeah. And they were just having a great time, and champagne was flowing, and people were just hobbing and hot-nobbing with each other. Oh, this is great. The paparazzi was there, and pictures were taken, and they were having a great time. And all of a sudden, the door knocked. And the owner of the house said, I wonder if this is a, you know, Dennis Rodman, or this is a, I'm dating myself because I really don't know who's famous right now. And he goes and he opens the door, and it was the devil. And the devil says, excuse me, I know I wasn't invited, because the devil's never invited into your heart, into your life. He's never invited. He says, who's the owner of this house? He says, well, I am the owner of this house. So the devil goes and pushes him to the side and goes inside the house. And he starts to destroy the house. He takes the sofa. He has a chainsaw. He cuts it in half. He has paint. He splatters all the walls with paint. He's got acid. He's putting acid on the expensive carpet that came from France. And he's destroying, and people are just running. They're, oh, my God, what is this? And he's destroying everything. And, oh, what great damage. Everybody left. The owner of the house was kind of depressed. He said, oh, this is terrible. This is horrible. Oh, well, okay. So he called Macy's, and he called JCPenney's, and he ordered the furniture again. And he may have called IKEA. I don't know. I don't know the details. But he called. He came in. The painters came in, and he ordered another carpet from France from Amazon. And he came in, and everything. And he fixed it. He says, well, listen, no one's going to stop me. I'm going to party on. I'm going to party. And he did another party, and everybody was there. Everybody was, all the A-listers were there. And, you know, Mike Tyson was there. And everybody was there. And everybody was dancing. And they all danced like this. I don't know why. But they all danced like that. And they were having a great time. All of a sudden, who could that be? Opens the door. Oh, it's you again, says devil. Yes, I am again. He says, you're not invited here. Says, I don't have to be invited. Who's the owner? Well, I'm the owner. Pushes him to the side. Does a greater destruction than before. He comes in and drives with a 4x4 in the living room. And he goes and he brings goats and chickens. And he just destroys the place. And the man was helpless. Some of you have been helpless seeing your life fall apart. Some of you, all you could do is just watch. Have you ever felt helpless? Amen. I have. And I've won. I hope that was Jesus. I hope Jesus is calling you. Because that would be so cool. Like Jesus, hey, are you in my house? Yeah. He destroyed everything again. He did this two more times, and every single time he thought he was living his life the right way, and he was trying to enjoy life, and it came to a point where the devil kept destroying everything. And someone said to him, why are you so sad? He says, I keep trying to live my life. I wanted to do these parties. I have this nice house. I want to be happy. I want to be successful. But this devil keeps coming in. And he says, you know what? I know this guy. He has a company called JC Protection Services. JC Protection Services. Some of you will get this on the way home. JC Protection Services. Yeah, you'll get it. You'll get it. It's okay. So he calls up JC Protection Services. And guess who answers the phone? JC, of course. Yes, yes, can I help you? Listen, I've got a problem with the devil. I've heard that you can defeat the devil. I heard you have power over the devil. Can you come and help me? And JC says, absolutely. Whenever I'm invited, I show up. Whenever Jesus is invited, you just have to invite him. You just have to invite him. And some of you have stopped inviting him a long time ago. And today, God is just touching your heart, says, invite me, I'll come right back in. Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, JC comes in. He does an assessment. He gives him a quote. He says, listen, I'll do this for free since you invited me. Where do you want me to? Want me to protect the whole house? Yes, JC, protect the whole house. He says, okay, I'm on the clock. And the man said, but JC, I don't mean to offend you. But tonight we're having one of these parties. Woo! Some people are gonna feel uncomfortable you being here. Can you like stay upstairs and don't come down to the party? Just, in fact, there's a room upstairs. Can you just stay there until the party's over? JC says, absolutely. I'm only come when I'm invited. You want me to stay in that room? And he went up there into that room. And the party started going. And this man, see, because when we have religion, it gives us a false sense of security. Religion will give you a false sense of religion of security. A relationship with God will give you the power of God in reality. Amen. This man had religion. He had Jesus in his house. You can have a picture of Jesus in your living room. It doesn't mean he's in your heart. You can believe in Jesus Christ. It doesn't mean you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. This man had Jesus Christ in his house. And in the middle of the party, the devil comes knocking again. And he opens the door. And the devil says, who's the owner? He says, I'm the owner. But wait. And before he finished, he came and destroyed the whole house all over again. The next morning, this man is sitting on the stairs, on his stairs, just crying. What am I going to do? And Jesus smelled the eggs and bacon that were cooking. And Jesus came down. And Jesus says, do I smell bacon? I says, yeah. But Jesus, look at this all destroyed. You were here. Why didn't you defend me? And Jesus says, oh, I think you misunderstood. I only defend what belongs to me. If this is your house, you've got to defend it. But if you give me your home, your heart, your family, your faith, whatever keeps you up at night, give it to me. I will fight your battles. As he was saying that, there was a doorknob. And the man says, oh, God, that sounds like the devil knocking. You know, you can recognize his knock. You know, this sounds like the devil knocking. I'm going to have to go. And Jesus said, what are you doing? No. I'm going to answer the door because this is my house. And he answered the door, and the devil said, he looked at what, took one look at Jesus. He says, I've got the wrong house, and left. You need to start building a basket, but before you put it in a basket, you need to give it to God. And you need to trust God that he will fight your battles. Because there's some battles you cannot fight. There's some things you cannot win. The devil is way more powerful than you. But God defeated him 2,000 years ago on Calvary. Oh, the devil has no more power over you. Basket of prayer. Please pray. Pray day and night. I know, let me say this to you. Every time we pray, it seems like the person gets worse. I don't know if it happens to you, but when you pray for something, it seems like it's getting worse. And it's because the devil, if anybody knows the presence of God, is the devil. Because the devil used to be Lucifer, the angel of light. And he got so proud and that he wanted to be worshipped because he studied God. He was there for eons of years looking at God. And he says, you know what? I can do that. I should be worshipped. Look at this. He's invisible. But look at me. I'm Papi Chulo. Look, I'm good looking. They should be worshiping me. So if anyone knew the presence of God, if anyone knew how God moved, it was Lucifer because he studied him. He says, wait a minute, I should be doing that. And let me say this to you, that whenever Lucifer or the devil senses God doing something in your life, he puts the pressure on so that you can lose faith, so that you can stop praying. The worse it gets, the more you pray. The worse it gets, the more you cry out. The worse it gets, the more you praise him. Hallelujah! Your miracle is on its way. Pray. Pray, pray. You need a basket of miracles. Jesus said in Luke 18:27, what is impossible with man is possible with God. We serve a God of the impossible. I know you can't do it, but God can do it. I know you think it's too late, but it's not too late for God. I know you think you've made too many mistakes. There's no turning back. God is a God of second chances. God is a God that can turn back time. Let me tell you something. When Cher sang this song, it came from the Bible. If I can turn back time. No, God is the only one that can turn back time. Hallelujah. He's a God of second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth opportunities. He's a God of mercy. He's a God of redemption. You need a basket of prayer. You need a basket of the impossible. Because it's going in the Nile River. The attack will come. Sometimes we think because we're Christians, bad things won't happen to us. We think because we're Christians, our marriages are safe. Sometimes we think because we're Christians, I raised them up in the Lord, that your children are going to serve God. No. You could do everything right, and your kids could do everything wrong. And then you ask yourself, where did I go wrong? Can I? Yeah. You taught them right. You taught them right. You gave them foundation, and now you're visiting them in jail. And you go, where did I go wrong? You need a basket. You need to build a basket. Because in the midst of that Nile River, the hand of God will protect whatever you've placed in that basket. The basket will go through great things, but God is faithful. I don't know what challenge you're facing. We all have different challenges. We all have things that keep us up at night. But the Lord is speaking to you and saying, it's not too late. Build a basket. And I'll end with this. And it says that Jochebed put Moses' sister to watch from a distance what was going to happen to that basket. You need to watch with anticipation what God is going to do in your situation. You have to expect it. I don't know how, I don't know when, but I know that I know that I know that I know God is going to make a way. I don't know how, I don't know when, but I know that he's going to do something. It's an expectation. You're walking in expectation. I challenge you to walk in expectation. I serve a powerful God. I expect a powerful God. I serve a loving God. I'm looking for a loving God. I'm looking for a miracle. The God of miracles, he's my God. You may need a miracle. Hallelujah. You've got the right guy. Hallelujah. God is a God of miracles. Is a basket you've made a basket of doubt? Is it a basket of despair? Have you given up? I want to talk to the people that stopped dreaming. I want to talk to the people that at one time you had hopes, you had dreams, you had aspirations, and something happened where a switch was flipped and you stopped dreaming. You're living, but something has died inside of you. And you can have faith in God, and this can still happen to you. Amen. I'm here to say to you, God has brought you here to flip that switch back on again. You need to start dreaming. You need to start believing God for the impossible. You need to have hope. You need to have peace. You need to let God put the pieces back together again. I know many of you are broken. I know many of you are trying your very best to live your life, but you failed. And the devil reminds you every single day. But I'm here to say to you, there's a basket you need to build. And God is going to honor your basket. And from a distance, expect God to do the miracle. I may not be able to do the miracle, but he can. Have you ever tried to fix something and make it worse? Have you ever tried to fix something and made it worse? Yes, I have too. So I'm not talking to you from a judgmental point of view of saying, I'm better than you. You better get your life together. No, I'm talking about someone who had to build a basket. I remember me and my wife, we raised up our kids, PKs, pastor's kids, and we included them in everything. Every time we went on a trip, we took them with us. They were homeschooled. We taught them the word of God. We loved on them. We were good parents, you know. And I don't say that in pride, but when you're good, you're good. And we were good parents. And at the age of 18, my daughter said, and she was saying this from the age of 11, when I'm 18, I'm going to leave the home. And we never really, I said, you're 11 years old, what are you talking about? And on her 18th birthday, she left home. And that broke our hearts. Because she left home in rebellion. She was an 18-year-old thinking she was an adult. Have you ever met people that think they are adults, but they're actually children? Well, my daughter left, and her life took a turn for the worst. And one day, she'll share her testimony. But we had built a basket for her, basket of faith, basket of hope, a basket of prayer. We prayed for her every single day. And it was amazing that we were able to minister to other people and reconcile their families and bring their families back together. But yet we didn't know where our daughter was. It was a bittersweet time in our lives. But we had built a basket. And from a distance, we watched. No guarantees. We watched in prayer. We watched in faith. We watched in hope. And it seems that we would get news of her and things were just getting worse and worse and worse. But Nancy and I did not give up. God gave her to us. We were not going to surrender her to the devil. And we built that basket. And at due time, she came back home and she got to know the Lord. And now you see her here worshiping in our service. Only God can do that. Today, I would encourage you. For you mothers, hold on to your basket. Build a basket. Pray for your children. Pray for your family. Build that basket. I know you've been in war zone. I know you've been in a war zone. But build your basket. And for you other people, build your basket. Maybe whatever is really important to you is at risk right now. Is going to go into the Nile River. But God is speaking into your heart. And he's telling you, build a basket. It ain't over. God has the last word. It ain't over. Build your basket. Can we stand? Can we have the house lights on, please? I want to give you a keep, all the mothers a keepsake, something to remind you of building a basket. If you're a mother, can you please come up here? Just put it in the basket. Just come up here. Yeah, yeah. If you're a mother, please come up here. Let's make room for all the mothers, please. If you are a mother, come, please. I thank God for you women. I really thank God for you women. Let me say this to you. If procreation was left up to men, there'll be nobody here on earth. We wouldn't do it. I'm telling you. I remember, can we just make some room over here? Just come up here. I remember when my wife was giving birth and I had just come out of a night shift and I was so tired, but I was there for my wife. I was there and she was, and we, at that point, Lamaze was a big thing. And then I was telling her, breathe, breathe, breathe. And I was breathe. And let me tell you this, I testify to you as I'm on this pulpit right now. I just closed my eyes for 2 seconds. I just went like this. And all of a sudden, my wife, her head started spinning around. And she says, how dare you sleep? And slime and fire started coming out of her eyes. Ah! As you see, I was traumatized. But man, she gave birth to two human beings. You guys have given birth to a human being. God bless you. Today we honor you. Wow, I can't give a birth to a human being. Amen. So what we did is, it's a little basket. And I want you to put it wherever it will remind you. On those days when you just want to give up, just put it somewhere. And it says, build your basket. When things get really tough and it seems hopeless, build your basket. Amen. So please, let's give these out. If we have to get more, we have more downstairs. Let's pass this, please. Thank you. If we need more, there's downstairs more. Does everyone have a basket over there? Aren't these little cute? They're cute. You know that we read this in books and they lived happily ever after. And it's our hope to have that ending to our stories. But sometimes in some chapters of our lives, it doesn't end that way. They're not happily ever after. But even in those moments, you can still build a basket. Even in those moments, faith can arise. And when faith arises, healing, there's strength, there's peace. You may still have the same problems, but you are a different person. Build that basket of faith, of prayer, of hope, of miracles. I don't know about you, but I have a list of miracles I need. Do you have a list of miracles you need? I don't know, but there's some things, and I'm expecting them, like a kid at Christmas. I'm expecting them, and I know my God will be faithful. Can we say a special prayer over these women? God bless you. Pastora, did you get your basket? Go get your basket. Give her a basket, because I don't want anyone excluded. Let's extend our hands towards these beautiful women. Father God, in the name of Jesus, you are the God of the brokenhearted. You're the God of hope and peace. And today, through your Holy Spirit, you've spoken words of life to us. And you spoke to us about this woman, Jochebed, who believed you. That despite and in spite her circumstances, she built a basket for her promise, Moses. And that which was threatened became Moses. That which was taken out of the Nile. I pray that you may grant these women that gift, that Moses. That whatever it is, and each one has an individual need, whatever it is, let that need become a Moses. That which is drawn out of the Nile. I pray, Lord, that you may start a work of healing and restoration, a work of clarity and revelation. I pray that as they look upon this little basket, even so symbolically, that faith may arise within them, and hope and peace and healing may be their portion. Father, I bless them in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we say amen, amen. And amen. Can we give the Lord a praise? Amen. God bless you. God bless you. You could go back to your seats. We have one more presentation, and then we're going to. Yes. 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 We have a special dance. I'm going to ask you just to wait a couple of minutes. But before we do that, we want to do a special presentation to honor these women. And Pastor Nancy, just. Who's this for?
Diane.
These flowers are for Diane Simpson. She's not here today, but we want to honor her. This is her daughter, Denise, and we love Diane, and we honor her. And we're standing on her shoulders. You know, sometimes we forget, and we see this nice things, and we go, oh, this is nice, and we forget that there are people that paid a price, that laid the foundation so that we can have what we have today. We will never forget Diane Simpson. Just want you to know that. And I never want you to forget this woman of God, Diane Simpson. She couldn't be here today because of her health, but we love her. Is Kelly here? Kelly Wozniak. Kelly, come. I know it's tough. Come up here. Yes. Thank you, honey. I've got, you know, my advisor telling me stuff. Amen. Kelly is a fighter. She's literally fighting for her life. And I remember talking with her in my office. And even though she has no guarantees, she has faith. And she has hope. Amen. in the Lord. Amen. Come. We want to honor you today. We want to honor you today. Kelly, here are some flowers. We want to honor you today as you are an example to all of us that if she can make it, you too can make it. Amen. I know we made you walk up here, but I wanted people to see how beautiful you are. Okay? God bless you. Let's just extend your hands. Father, we pray for these women of God. Thank you for their lives. Today we stand upon their example, their faith and their hope. Honor them because they have honored you. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let's give a round of applause. Thank you. Let's help her. Amen. They're going to help you back. Amen. We're going to end with a Mother's Day dance done by mothers. Is everyone a mother on that team? Everyone's a mother. Amen. 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 Do you guys have a name? No? The mommies? Can we call them? The mommies.
Not a mommy. Gail's a part of the team.
Oh, Gail's not a mommy. Okay.
So, I don't know. Magnolia dance. I don't know.
The Magnolia dance. Let's give a warm welcome to these young ladies. Amen. Come on, folks. Yes. Praise the Lord. Amen. Yes. Beautiful, beautiful. I'm going to ask my dad to come up. This week, we celebrate his 80th birthday. My dad. Pop, come. I want him to dismiss us in prayer. Come, come, Pop. Amen. 80 years old. Amen. I hope I reach 80 years old. Amen. Pop, come. Despídenos en oración. Lo puedes hacer en español. Sí. Claro que sí. Esta gente entiende en español. Claro.
Más fuego, más fuego.
Amen. Let's see. Sí. He's going to dismiss us in prayer. Go ahead. Ora.
Aleluya. Amen. 80 years old, right?
80.
Wow. Yes.
Aleluya.
Yes, hallelujah, glory. And I feel like 40 years old. 80, but I feel 40 years old. All right? Because I feel strong and healthy in the name of Jesus. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glad. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah for this privilege. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I never think I'm going to get 80 years old. And today, they celebrate for me, and I celebrate for you in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, hallelujah, because you always be good to me and be good to every one of us. Oh, thank you, Jesus, hallelujah. I praise you, I praise you, Lord, because you be good and good and good in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Yes, thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. Now we dismiss in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And all people say, amen. Glory.
Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you and go in the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Have a great Sunday.